Hello, my name is Dan Popescu. I'm an investment analyst specializing in precious metals and more specifically gold and silver. I have quite a few subjects to talk this week, and it's actually a review of some of the major issues the world is facing right now in 2016, and that relates very much to the international monetary system and also at the same time to gold and the poor man's gold, which is silver, because they are quite related the two between each other. They've been currencies for a long time, and even though in the last 30-40 years silver has been taken out of the international monetary system, it has remained de facto the poor man's gold. And in monetary crisis, when governments attack cash, people run very fast into gold and also into silver, contrary to some people who believe that silver has no role to play anymore in the international monetary system. And in this report, I would like to cover some of the major events that can have an incredible impact on the international monetary system. The first one that I want to cover, I covered it 2 weeks ago and a month ago, and I'm coming back because I think it is important, is the Brexit referendum, which will ask the British people to and the Scots to decide if they want to remain in the European Union or not. I remind you that Great Britain is not a member of the euro currency, even though it is, even if it's not officially pegged, it follows the euro very closely. And it is the same for the Swiss franc and all the European currencies which are not part of the euro area. Now, it's very important, depending on what the results will be. I personally believe that based on the way the campaign, even if he had even recently some absurd statements, both from the Brexit people and the people, the pro-European Union people, it still has remained, the debate has remained quite civil, in my opinion and based on my observations. Yes, recently the Brexit people came out with that that ridiculous statement that the European ideal is a CIA, in a Nazi-inspired CIA creation that was put into the head of European elite, as Europeans were too stupid to think about it. Even if it's something stupid, Europeans don't need Americans to put them ideas into their head. And it was the president of the European Commission said it this week. It was mostly based on after the war idea of never again, because of the pain of the two world wars, which were so devastating. And I felt it, and I've heard it from my mother and my father, who have been victims of both the Nazi regime. My uncle, my mother's brother, died in Czechoslovakia. He was enrolled in the army when he became 18, and he was killed because no training in the first weeks after he joined the army in Czechoslovakia. And at 98 years old, I've heard my mother saying, "Why? Why did he have to die? He was just a baby." That's the phrase she said about 6 months before she died at 98. So to hear some idiotic Brexit and anti-European Union pretend that the European Union idea is a Nazi concocted, inspired CIA idea put into the head of some crazy bureaucrats, people even like de Gaulle, General de Gaulle, and Chancellor Adenauer, it's in my view idiotic and absurd. Now, some people will argue with me that the idea that that de Gaulle and Adenauer came is not what it was created in the 90s, but the idea, but that is just a difference in form. The ideal of a common Europe is a long one. We might disagree on what type of Europe, a centralized one or a decentralized one, but the ideal of a common Europe is very old and it dates to antiquity. It's true that Hitler used it as an excuse, but a statement that somebody brought to my attention just 2 days ago, I read the statement by Hitler. First of all, my first reaction, he didn't think about that. He read it somewhere. He didn't create that statement. And second, if he really believed in what he said in that sentence, my father, who suffered in the Second World War, hated the Nazis, would be proud to say that he admires Hitler rather than hate him and wish he rot in hell. So Hitler did the opposite of that sentence, of that ideal that we all are Europeans, we are the same. He didn't practice that. He believed that the Germans were different than the rest of the Europeans, that we are not all Europeans, that the Germans are some kind of superior. So the sentence that he said, I totally agree with it, no matter what some people say. I'm not ashamed to say it, that they might call me a Nazi, or my father, or my mother. And I remind those people that my father was a graduate of the Air Academy with a diploma as an Air Force pilot during the Second World War and highly decorated, fought the war on both sides. First, against Germany, then Romania, there was a military coup and it became allied with Germany. He fought in Crimea with Germany, even though the Germans considered him a potential traitor because he was coded and marked in file as a anti-Nazi and pro-ally. And then when the winds change, he fought with the Russians up into Czechoslovakia and went even up to Vienna. So, and as I mentioned before, I have many members of my family killed by the Nazis, tortured by the Nazis, and then by the communists. But it doesn't matter. Nazis and communists have preached something and they never did it. The ideal of communists is no much different than the ideal of the Bible. But did they apply it? No, I don't know any communist regime that applied the ideology that they've been preaching. So maybe Hitler preached a European Union. Maybe he said, and I think he did say it, that we are all Europeans. But that's not what he practiced. He believed that Germans are different than the Czechs, the Romanians, the Italians, and the French. And that he believed that the Germans should rule and all the other ones should be under the foot of Germany. That's not what that statement that somebody recently, a political scientist from what I understand, read to me. Because I agree with that statement that she read to me of a we are all Europeans of the same origins, but that's not what Hitler said. And we see statements also from the anti-Brexit people, which are exaggerations that Great Britain will go to hell, that Great Britain will not survive. That is not reasonable, that is also an exaggeration that I don't agree. Great Britain can survive outside of the European Union. It will not be a destruction of Europe because it can also be like Monaco next to France, the exception proves the rule. Small countries can survive next to a big one like Liechtenstein, like Monaco. That doesn't destroy the principle of a common Europe. And I'll also bring up, because sometimes Swiss bring to the attention that Europe should become back to Switzerland, a small country like Switzerland. And I read some of my books from when I was a student in Switzerland, history books. It was very interesting that the argument for creating a confederation in, I think it was 1240, I'm not very good with dates, 1240, when Switzerland, the confederation was created, the same reasoning was used by the Swiss to unite in a very decentralized confederation of independent states, which Switzerland is not at all today. Switzerland is confederation in name. In reality, today Switzerland is a federation, a high, not as centralized as United States or Canada, but it is no more a confederation. And it was designed at the origin by the fathers of the Swiss Confederation. It has become a much more, and actually it's more in reality, a federation than a confederation today, not a confederation of independent states. And the ideal of the Swiss of that time is to put an end to endless wars between neighboring cantons. So you see, the argument at a much bigger level comes back to the same argument that the Swiss did. And I'm quite sure in 1240, there were also people in the canton of Valais, in Zug and in Grison, who said, why have a superstructure like Switzerland? Makes no sense. It's undemocratic. I mentioned on Twitter this morning that a structure, a unified structure, doesn't mean necessarily a good or bad. You can have a big structure which is mismanaged, totalitarian, and you can have one which is democratic and humane. And you can have a small structure which is humane and democratic, like Switzerland, or totalitarian and inhumane, like Zimbabwe. So small, it's not necessarily beautiful. And big, it's not necessarily ugly. It all depends what you do with it. So both arguments in pro and against the European Union are hitting some extremes and some arguments which are completely ridiculous. I respect the people who support the Brexit ideal. I do not, I'm not on that side. But I respect, I understand their reasoning, and it makes sense. I prefer the European ideal of my parents and many, and of the Swiss in 1240. But it makes sense also for UK to be independent. Will UK survive? Will it be better or worse? That will depend on the British people. They can make their life better within Europe or outside of Europe. There is danger because of facts that I've been reading and talking, and I go regularly to the UK, that there will be a collapse of United Kingdom if they leave the European Union and create an identity crisis within UK. How will that happen? Can Britain survive alone? Scotland showed interest to remain in the European Union, and if collapse of Great Britain, they intend to request to rejoin the European Union. Can Britain, just Britain, survive? I'm sure they can, but they will have to make adjustments. The Queen will have to cut her extravagant life by at least 10 times. Because I expect the Commonwealth also to collapse. Australia will be the first one. They've been repeatedly wanting to leave the Commonwealth. So That will have an impact in the budget, the economy of Great Britain. Now, not all the businesses will run away from Great Britain like some people predict. Other businesses might join Britain to be outside of the European Union. So it's not a clear cut one way or another. It's a vision. It's an identity. I think that Mervyn King, the ex-governor of the Bank of England, said that if you vote for Brexit, you should not just go for monetary economic reason. It should be an ideal. And I agree with him. You believe in it or you don't. I'm a federalist, internationalist. My cousin is a localist. He doesn't even want France to be a country, or Italy to be a country, or Romania, my country of origin, which was for 10,000 years, but there are three main regions, Transylvania, Muntenia, and Moldova, who compose it. For a very short term during the Middle Ages, late of the Middle Ages, I think, 1700, I think it was split in three principalities, Transylvania, Muntenia, and Moldova. And for 5,000 years before that, it was together in one country. But for a very short period, when Europe was split in hundreds of independent principalities, Germany was split, Italy, France, and Romania, and many other Germany. Each one was small principalities. The idea of attachment to the local region, like my cousin who's attached to the local village, for him even the province doesn't exist. For him the country doesn't exist, and the world, it's something he doesn't give a damn. And I'm the other way around. So it's a philosophy. We can have debates for hundreds of years and will not agree on that kind of approach. I personally believe that because of technology of today, it has imposed structures like the European Union, continental unity of structure, because communications are so fast, so easy, that borders have become meaningless. And I think that unfortunate for those who dream of about Balkanization of Europe, of United States, of China, of Russia, the only way they will achieve their dream is to destroy the technology that of communications that has appeared in the last 100 years with the means of transportations, airplanes, fast trains, the internet, radio, television, which makes them much closer than we used to be, and we wouldn't accept anymore to go back to the time when you never spoke to your cousin in northern France because it was impossible or too expensive to do it. Today, it's unreal. So contrary to what some anti-European Union say, I think that the European Union was slowly imposed by reality, not a concoction by some bureaucrats, ideologue, mentally intoxicated by a Nazi CIA concoction that was put in their heads on people like de Gaulle and Adenauer and others. And if you know history, you will know that the idea of a united Europe goes to the Roman Empire. Now, it doesn't mean it has to be a democratic or a totalitarian. That's where the anti-Europeans try to say, hey, don't put de Gaulle in the same camp. Don't put Adenauer. No. De Gaulle and Adenauer dreamed of a Europe from the Atlantic to the Urals. They might disagree with the type of shape that it will come out. Confederate, federate, centralized, decentralized. But they did believe in a common Europe. Those who say that's not true They are lying. De Gaulle did believe, and De Gaulle and Adenauer and many others like my father and my mother said, after the wars, the pain, the disastrous death, especially after the First and Second World War through which they went, they said never again. And that's what they actually meant. Now, a common project like Europe, that doesn't mean it will be successful in being a humane one. It might end up a very bad, like Hitler imagined it, in which one country dominates the others, or it could be a very humane one where we all live happily ever after in that continent. We will see what happens. Now, right now, I said it in the last bulletin, I observed that the Brexit sentiment is moving away from the Brexit, the pro-Brexit. I still believe that they've lost momentum. They seem to have recaptured a little bit lately in the last week. I've observed a movement in their favor, but I think that the anti-Brexit movement is still moving in the positive direction. But don't look at the polls. They are very bad. In the last few years, pollsters have abandoned the methodology. They are not sampling. They are not creating very good samples. They are just doing some internet random calls without checking if the people that they are sampling really represent the whole broad prospectum and proportion of the population in Great Britain. Same thing in other polls in the United States for the election. So be careful with those polls. They have a margin of error of not of 3% as newspapers writing them, because they pay for those polls. The margin of error is never before, never under 20%. And when there is 40, 60, you can see how much it can distort the result when the real vote comes. But my observations, my talks right now make me believe that the momentum has switched towards the pro-Europeans, pro-European Union, against the Brexit. But very small incidents, misspoken sentences like Boris Johnston calling blacks and Obama frustrated that the Brits enslaved them, and because of their frustration they are voting against Brexit and talking against Brexit. I think that that statement hurt their camp incredibly. The other issue that it will have an impact, we've seen with the Brexit the fluctuations in the British pound. It's going to have an impact, and it will have an impact on gold. Either way, I think that the euro will gain if Brexit remains, and I think that the Brexit will suffer. I don't think the US dollar will gain from a Brexit vote. And the reason I don't believe that the US dollar will gain, it's for my other subjects that I want to cover, and that is the U.S. election. The United States is in a crisis, major crisis, political and social crisis. You can see it with the hate language that is going on now in the United States, anti-Hispanic language by Donald Trump. Even yesterday he made statements, refused to go back on his anti-Hispanic, making a difference between Americans and making sure he makes a distinction on pure species race of American, which if you are born in the United States but of Mexican descent, you are not a pure, worth American. I found that despicable statement from Donald Trump, it shows that kind of language will have a reaction in the Hispanic population, and we are seeing already trouble. I see the Mexican flag and Hispanics on protest movements at meetings of Donald Trump and the Republicans. So that can degenerate. The degeneration can come from one side or the other. For the moment, it's purely insults and words, but it could degenerate a lot more, and people like Donald Trump could inflame it. He's not gonna do it, but he could stimulate it or inflame it on one side or the other, and then you have reaction, and it gets to a point where nobody knows who said what and who was first, and that is weakening the US dollar and making that the US dollar will not gain from the weaknesses of the European euro, even if there is a Brexit vote. All the currencies today, major currencies, from the Japanese yen to the British pound, the euro, and the US dollar are weak. They have their own weaknesses, and you can see it in the index of the price of gold, in SDRs, with which is a composition of those four currencies, major currencies. And you can see that even if the price of gold has fallen much more in US dollars, it has not fallen in the index. It has resisted the down move quite strongly. And I saw that foreign exchange reserves, the dollar has not really profited. Movement and changes have not, problems in the European Union have not produced a run into the US dollar, which it should have produced. What actually happened was an increase in gold proportion in the international foreign exchange reserves, which indicates that people are scared of both the euro and the US dollar, the British pound and the yen, which are the components of the SDR, the international currencies of this moment. So United States has not taken advantage of the weakness due to the European Union problems and the Brexit and the Greek crisis. So another issue related that I want to mention, and that is Switzerland and gold. I've talked before, I wrote a few articles last year before the referendum in Switzerland about gold in Switzerland. And one of the reasons you have money running into the Swiss franc away from the British pound and the euro is because Switzerland has always inspired confidence. And even in the 1970s, because people think that it's only today that you have negative interest rates in Switzerland, they introduced penalties in Switzerland in the 1970s because money was running into the Swiss franc, out of the US dollar especially, but also the French franc, the British pound, the Italian lira, the Deutsche Mark. It was going into Switzerland. And the reason that the Swiss were able to charge a fine and negative interest rates was because people were so scared of the country where they were ready to pay a penalty, losing 2%. I talked with the petrodollars in Saudi Arabia in my last reports. It's the same thing with the money running into the Swiss franc, is that yes, they are punishing me to put my money in Swiss francs, but it is better than putting it in US dollar, where it could be confiscated by the US government, or in British pound, or in the euro, where it could be confiscated. So that's the reason that it goes into Switzerland. Switzerland has a reputation good management of public resources. Doesn't like debt and going into frivolous expenses. And I'm coming to this subject today because there was a few referendums this weekend, today actually, in Switzerland, and my indication from the results is that It is a continuation of the election a few months ago, where Switzerland is going more and more conservative, back into the conservative side, the traditional way of Switzerland for sound money. They indicated that they are not going to eliminate the 1,000 francs note like Europe, which eliminated the 500 francs. United States doesn't have a higher than 100. And Great Britain, I think it's 50 pounds. And Canada eliminated the higher notes. And I think the highest in Canada also today, it's 100. And Switzerland has indicated its intention to remain a country of good management of public resources, no waste of public money, through the election and now through those referendums now. Now, I make a distinction here, and that is the management of the Central Bank of Switzerland, the National Bank, the Swiss National Bank. I think the management of the Swiss National Bank is highly indoctrinated in the American economics and finance school of the 80s and 90s of admiring debt, admiring paper money and waste. And they control it. They still control it. During the referendum on the gold reserves last year, it was evident the panic of the federal. I've listened to one debate with members of the National Bank of Switzerland in the debate, arguing and dismissing hard money as relics of antiquity, and I could hear the language of the economics books that I also studied from, typical American of Samuelson's and others that were taught even in Europe, sometimes not even bother to translate them in French or German or Italian. And that mentality, that American love for debt, which Donald Trump exemplifies very well, and he said it, I'm the king of debt, it dominates the bank, the National Bank of Switzerland, which is in contradiction with the population, and the electorate and the elections have moved, has indicated a move towards the traditional hard money attitude. So those who supported the increase of gold reserves in Switzerland won the elections, the majority of the elections in the last election. I wrote an article where I said that I wouldn't be surprised. I wrote it last year that after the referendum, that I wouldn't be surprised a change in the executive or a change in attitude by the National Bank of Switzerland. It hasn't happened. I've been proven wrong for the moment. The attitude of the Swiss National Bank, it's still print money and peg to the euro and maintain the euro. The president of the National Bank during the referendum last year and the whole team vehemently was defending and said clearly they will keep the peg of the Swiss franc to the euro and there is nothing that will make them change their mind. The peg is there to stay. Only that 6 weeks, I think, after the referendum, they broke the peg, contrary to what they said. Now, the Swiss National Bank, even if Switzerland's a small country, remains a bureaucracy like every bureaucracy in the world. I lived in Switzerland and I know. And even if bureaucracy is smaller in Switzerland, it's still bureaucracy. And I know that those kinds of decisions are not taken by a king, King Jordan, president of the Swiss National Bank, alone by flipping a coin 2 minutes after taking taking the decision. That those decisions are taken, analyzed by committees. Reports are prepared by staff. By young analysts. There's committee over committee and analysis. So the decision to unpeg was made, I'm quite sure, I have no proof, but I'm quite sure it was made before the referendum was done, while the president of the National Bank and the board were preaching that they will never break the peg of the Swiss franc to the euro. So if they did it once, if they misled the Swiss voter once, they can do it again in the other direction and concoct a very good argument that politicians, economists, political scientists, as they call themselves, I don't like to call them scientists, would make a very good story to justify a decision that they preached for years that they will not do, or for weeks or for months. So the attitude towards gold in Switzerland, I think it's also, I wouldn't be surprised to change, keeping in mind that the majority now of the elected people in Switzerland are for parties who supported the increase in gold reserves. So that is something to watch also very carefully. Keep in mind that recently, and I spoke to you in the recent, in the last report, that even in United States, major economists who are against gold has recommended emerging markets to buy gold at least 10% of their reserves and sell U.S. treasuries, targeting mostly China, which has about 2.2% at this moment, but which doesn't need the advice of Professor Rogov. It has been doing it since 2008 with Russia, and very fast and in large quantities. But the statement from Mr. Rogov could have a major impact, because he's not just anybody. He could be member of the Federal Reserve Bank Board of Directors, and maybe governor, chairman of the Fed. So keep a watch on Switzerland. The recent vote this weekend indicates the Swiss are very conservative. They don't want to vote expenses, not even for roads. I don't have the final result, but it seems that even the vote for increase in spending for improving roads in Switzerland was voted down. I don't have the final results, but it seems that it was defeated. Another issue with impact on gold that happened this week, and I want to mention it, is the conflict between Iran and Saudi Arabia. I wrote an article about a month ago, 2 months ago, on the issue on the gold reserves of Iran and Saudi Arabia, which are very opaque. So my whole article is educated guesses, if you want, speculation, because we don't have the information. And the role of the petrodollar, I wrote my most current article is on the petrodollar collapse, which everything indicates it's close to the end. There is a major conflict between Saudi Arabia and the U.S. The prince of Saudi Arabia, who's in charge of the most operations today, is supposed to make a visit to United States. They are mad at hell at United States. So it's something to watch very careful. I expect the petrodollar to end slowly, fast but surely. It's going in that direction. The major oil producers today is not member of OPEC. It's Russia, and the major consumer is China. And they both signed agreements to buy, sell oil, but not in priced in dollars, but in yuan and maybe rubles. So that is something that will have an impact on the price of gold. Keeping in mind again that both China and Russia are buying gold in large quantities. I think they are underestimating the amount of gold that they have. I think China buy at least at half, and I wouldn't be surprised Russia also buy at least at half. I wouldn't be surprised that they have on the different institution named the gold already there. All it takes is an accounting switch from one to the other, and it's done. So that is something that has to be watched carefully. The SDR, which has been presented as the solution to the exorbitant to replacement of the US dollar, seems to me, as I mentioned to you on several reports, not on the right track. It needs consensus. There is no consensus. The recent meeting last week of the G7 indicates that there is no consensus. Interests are not converging, but by diverging. And even if they don't admit it, the currency wars will continue and degenerate, in my view, with periods of pause, if you want. So, and you also have in something that I want to mention and could have a major impact. I think people look at United States, they look at the dragon bear, what's Russia and China, but people forget Europe. Europe, it's becoming a major player, and it's regaining its power that it lost after the Second World War, where it was broken into pieces, completely destroyed militarily, economically, whatever, in any form that you want to say. Europe has recovered economically, it has recovered militarily. The military industries in Europe today are actually better than American, equal in some, better than in other domain, and competing on equal footing with the United States on that. And Europe has it has the largest amount of gold reserves, has been speaking constantly, very positively. All the central banks of Europe and the European Union, Eurozone, Mr. Draghi, have constantly spoken very positively on about gold reserves. So giving signals that they are very open to something on gold. And as I mentioned in previous reports, several statements, I reread a lot of the reports on the collapse of the Bretton Woods and all the period from 1971 to 1990. And you can see clearly the divergence between Europeans, as the State Department and the Treasury Department were calling very pro-European, and made sure that even after the collapse of the Bretton Woods, gold will still keep its role in the international monetary system through the IMF, and United States, which wanted complete elimination of gold. So watch that conflict and a possible alliance at the international monetary system level between Europe, Russia, and China. And I see India joining in very easily, listening to the president of the Federal Bank of India. I see a collusion, if you want, a coalition being created, and United States the only player alone supporting the dollar and being anti-gold. There is one event that you have to watch carefully. I'm looking very careful, watching carefully to see what happens and how it evolves. The president of the European Commission has announced that Jean-Claude Juncker, that he will be in Russia. That visit has infuriated the State Department and United States. They are working very hard to have it canceled or limit its meetings in Russia. And today there was an article in the press, and Sputnik, a Russian agency, quoting that Angela Merkel said today in Lisbon, I hope that Russia would increasingly develop ties with the European economic area, finally resulting in a common economic area from Lisbon to Vladivostok. Okay, she goes farther than General de Gaulle, who said from Lisbon to the Urals, from the Atlantic to the Urals. Angela Merkel says from Lisbon, so from the Atlantic to the Pacific, to Vladivostok. So very interesting statement, because I've observed politicians in Europe, in France, Sarkozy, several prime ministers, ex-prime ministers of France, from the left and from the right, in Italy, the prime ministers, present and past, in Germany, opposition, and from the Angela Merkel's government, many, many people talking that it's time to end the sanctions against Russia and get a restart collaboration with Russia. And Russia, Putin, has never attacked Europe after the sanctions, and during the sanctions, he always made sure, and his prime ministers, in every interview, every speech, they always made sure they don't attack Europe, and they kept contact with Europe. They only made attacks against the United States, so kept the door open for a new alliance, and they constantly talk about an Euro-Asia free trade zone. So watch that carefully, how it evolves. It can also have an impact on the international monetary system and gold. And keep in mind, China is in charge of G20 this year and has created a working committee, as I mentioned before, led by France, from Europe, from the European Union, and they invited Switzerland, quite pro-gold, if you want, to be on that working group with South Korea and China, I guess. No sign yet that that United States has joined that working committee. So very interesting. It's why they are not part of the committee, and are they opposed to it? I didn't see any news about it up to now. So I'll come now to a topic that I want to fast cover also, and that is the war on cash. We hear very much about it. Some people say there is no war on cash, other people saying there is a war on cash. I think there is one. I don't think they will win it, but I think that they will try it very hard. It started very slowly in the 1980s. In the United States, let me find the date. I think it was 1986 when the United States passed the Money Laundering Control Act. That was the first time when they wanted banks to verify large transactions. At that time, it was over $10,000, and to check it. Banks, not stupid and very greedy, they said, I'm not going to do the checking. I'm not going to check each transaction to see if it's criminal or not. It's too much work, and we're not lawyers. So what the banks did, they said, we'll pass it to the agency, all the transactions that go over $10,000, which created chaos in the governments in Canada and the United States, because Canada copied the United States very fast. And I worked in banks in the back office at that time, and it was hell. Nobody wanted to verify the transactions, and it created problems with citizens, decent citizens. I remember a lawyer, a friend of mine, who bought a house in Oklahoma, and the transaction was lost. He had a deal with the seller in the United States, But the funds were blocked to be checked by the agencies for anti dirty money agency, and by the time that agency cleared it, it was too late. The seller found somebody else and sold it to somebody else. So my friend lawyer lost a deal that he really wanted. This is the type of problems that were created. And then they went further. After September 11, they decided to they used the excuse to introduce laws. That was the sneaky Dick Cheney and George W. Bush. Dick Cheney especially, who had a plan, but in the past said it's not going to work, but because of September 11, now we can push it. And they made those controls even tougher. From 10,000, they went down to regular transactions of 1,000. If they match up 10,000, in a recent newsletter by Jim Rickards, he talks about U.S. banks will report anyone taking more than $3,000 in cash. Large cash transactions have been banned in the United States, also in Europe, Canada. So the war in cash is evident that it is going on, and it comes to also to the war that it's described, and actually the creator in the Treasury Department by Juan Zarate, who after leaving wrote a book about it and describing it. The Treasury war, Treasury's war, using the Treasury, using the international monetary system to attack at enemies like Russia, China, Iran, and all that. But I have to give it to the author. He cautions the United States by saying, don't abuse it. We need for this war to work. We need support of allies. Otherwise, it will not work. And I think that greed in the Treasury Department and in the U.S. government makes it that they pushed it farther than he was saying, and they are doing it without the collaboration of the Europeans or Russians or the Chinese, the international system. And I think that what it has created is people avoiding the dollar. It might be hard to use physical gold. Some people are saying, well, it's hard to use physical gold. Well, if you're given the choice of having your assets freezed or stolen by the U.S. government under all kinds of pretexts and carrying 100 grams or 1 gram, I bet you you're going to choose the pain of carrying that 1 gram. So when it comes in facility of using a currency, the safety goes first. You prefer a cashless society, but if I tell you you're going to lose everything if you choose facility, you're going to say, okay, I'll carry the gold in my pocket. And I'm coming here to an article that 2 years ago, Hugo Salinas Price, famous in Austrian economics from Mexico, wrote an article of paper money and digital money and gold. And he gives an example of a bank in Mexico. And he explains how hard it is for foreign banks to still use the U.S. dollars and therefore choosing just avoid purely and simply the U.S. dollar. He gives the example, I'll read you the paragraph very shortly, a short paragraph. A bank in Mexico, of which I have personal knowledge, receives millions in dollars in dollar bills every week in thousands of individual money exchange transactions. These dollar bills, mostly 20s, for credit to the Mexican bank's account. apparently, it would be necessary to present to the Americans a lifetime resume of each one of the individuals exchanging their dollar bills for pesos in order to prove that there is no money laundering going on. Impossible to do with these tens of thousands of transactions. Imagine millions of transactions of individuals, grandmothers, not just criminals, grandmothers who give $20 to their son or to their nephew and depositing it into a bank, and the bank required by the U.S. government to prove the identity and the provenance of each one of the deposits, $20 bill deposits. Now, if you don't think that will convince institutions and individuals to stop using the U.S. dollar, I'm not going to make more comments about your capacity of analyzing human nature. And I've seen it in Europe also. And we had the famous case I talked to you before of BNP Paribas, who used the dollar internationally and never broke the American law, but strength of the American imagination, they managed to make a link and forced BNP Paribas found it guilty just because they used the U.S. dollar and made them pay fines. And at this point now, many institutions worldwide refuse to use the dollar. And slowly but surely, it is not just Iran who's abandoning the dollar, but many others in physical. And it goes into what? Into the most marketable and the most easiest to use physical thing, because you cannot do that with land, with a house. I said it before, land, house is not better, not worse than gold, but gold is the most marketable, the most flexible to use, to carry of all the hard assets. That is the success of gold and silver. I have here a 1 gram, which is about $50, 10 grams, maybe about $500. You can put in your hand, my palm, okay? An iPhone size is $40,000 or euros that you can carry very easily in your pocket. So choosing between buying dollars that no bank will accept because you have to prove the identity of your grandmother and your great-great-great-great-grandfather, if it was legally or not, and if it was used in drugs or not, for every $20 bill, American dollar bill, do you think you're going to still use the U.S. dollar? This is the thing that I think it's the biggest enemy of the U.S. dollar, that Americans don't realize that this war on cash, it's going to have a damaging effect on the U.S. dollar mostly. But even other countries, because it was proposed by economists like Rogoff, to abandon, to block, to stop printing physical money, except very, very small amounts. And the purpose, Mr. Rogoff said it in an interview and in an articles, the purpose was for a link to a government bank account for all transactions. You can effectively centrally plan everything. So the purpose of banning cash, the idea, as Mr. Rogoff, and in Europe, because it's not just in the United States, in Europe it's another economist like him from Citi, Willem Bitter, who proposes the same thing with the same idea. We should ban cash so the state could tax fast and individuals not be able to protect themselves. So you can see the plans and the war on cash. There is a war on cash. I don't think they will win it, because there is so much gold running around which is not in the hands of the central banks that can very fast and very easy, and we've seen recently in the last year the amount of gold coins and gold bars of 1 gram and gold coins in silver and gold has exploded. So it indicates very clearly that people are preparing for it, and it will be very hard for governments to control it, to ban this. They will have some effect, and they need global coordination. And as is with the SDR, it doesn't seem that you're going to have a global coordination of banning cash, because if they only ban it in the United States, it creates loopholes, and like any embargo, boycott against Iran, Cuba, Russia, they all failed. South Africa, they all failed, no matter what people say. So this is what I wanted to talk to you this week. The next in 2 weeks, it will be just before the Brexit vote. We'll see the tendency is. I don't think we're gonna get much information. I think it's still very close. It will depend of the vote coming out, but it's interesting. And United States events are degenerating on both sides. And you could have Donald Trump doesn't show any interest in moderating his speech. And in both sides, Hillary Clinton is weak. She has major weaknesses. She can stumble very fast. And Donald Trump doesn't want to work with a team, doesn't want to prepare speeches, speaks out of spontaneously. And he can, I think that the Mexican for me it is clearly, and I was disappointed because I used to like the way Donald Trump presented himself 15-20 years ago. The statement against Mexicans, it's purely discriminatory of the best kind, apartheid, call it fascism, whatever you want to call it. It is despicable. The judge against him who was talking is an American born. He's no less American than him. And in recent interview yesterday, he refused to backtrack at all from that statement, showing that he has intention of being even more racist with the birth certificate of Obama. It was purely racist statement. And against blacks, and I'm worried that clashes worse than those that happened in the 70s will start. But this time I think it will be more with the Latinos and the Mexicans in the United States than with the black community, but also with the black community, because there are many blacks who are Muslims, like Muhammad Ali, Cassius Clay, which just passed away this weekend. So this is what I wanted to speak to you this week. Until the next time, have a nice 2 weeks until the next time. Goodbye.